Hey, good morning, my friends. This is Michael, and a very happy Tuesday to all of you. Thank you again for your kind comments regarding my video tribute to my favorite book on card magic, Cardshark. I'm so thrilled to know that many of you out there are enjoying this conversation and doing whatever you can to source a copy of the book for yourselves. I can tell you from first-hand experience, you'll get a lot of value from that one book over the years to come. Now, today's conversation really is a continuation of that wonderful book by Darwin Ortiz, because I'd like to draw your attention to this book, Scams and Fantasies. I really love that title, Scams and Fantasies. As the name implies, it's a celebration of gambling and real wish fulfillment fantasy of card magic. Now, this book was published in, let me just check the copyright date. This is important because Cardshark was published in 1995, and Scams and Fantasies, that's interesting. I can't see a publication date. Let's have another quick look. Okay, well, this is my signed copy from Darwin, and it says 2002. So let's take that as read. So 95, 2002. What makes this really interesting for me? When you read it, I got the feeling that the conversation where Cardshark left was continued right where this book begins. So for me, Scams and Fantasies is a continuation of Cardshark. Does it surpass Cardshark? In my opinion, no, it wasn't designed to. And I know Darwin doesn't think like that. He only thinks in terms of publishing what he considers to be the absolute best material that he's created. And this book is indicative of that belief system. So just consider for a moment, what makes this book special? Have you ever struggled to put together a creative, compelling presentation for your routines? Well, if you study Scams and Fantasies, each routine is a lesson in creating a strong narrative for your routines, okay? In fact, Darwin actually gives you the script for some of the routines he's put together in this book. And for me, this is a fantastic book, and it can stand alone on its own merit and be judged accordingly. But when you read it as a continuation of Cardshark, well, it presupposes that you've done the work. You've mastered certain techniques. Not only that, you're in a position now to fully actualize your potential as a performing artist. This book will challenge you because it raises the bar. And it encourages you, it certainly encouraged me, to look at how am I presenting my card work? Is it just a cold-blooded technical demonstration, or am I striving to communicate and express something about myself? True story. When this book was published, I began to inquire for myself, what kind of card man am I? Am I a gambling expert? Am I a magician where magical things happen? Yes, to a degree. Or am I a sleight of hand artist? I looked at those three core identities, and the one that spoke to me the most was sleight of hand artist. What does that mean? Well, a gambling expert has very little margin for error. I'm going to execute a specific technique. Watch me do it. Boom, 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 boom. All done, four aces, royal flush in the hand. A magician, well, consider, with just a wave of the hands, something disappears. Nothing happens other than the experience of magic. Now, the sleight of hand artist lives right in the middle of those two realms for me. It just means that I've expanded my narrative. I can still do magical effects, and I can still celebrate the magic of sleight of hand mastery without shoving it down the audience's throat. Hey, look what I can do, which you can't. You wouldn't want to be playing cards with somebody like me. No, that's not my style. I have friends who go down this road and they do it far better than I ever could. My friend Jason, for example, he's a master at this. Darwin is a master. So I like to keep whatever skill I have in stealth mode, operation, under the radar. Why is that? Because my style is very whimsical. There's a touch of fantasy, and my storytelling capability allows me to focus on the narrative, the story that I want to share with my audience. Yes, magic will happen. Yes, they will experience extraordinary things, but it's the story and the narrative that hooks them. Okay, so today I would like to give you a little example of this from one of the great gems in this book. This book is full of gems. Here's one of them. Okay, now this is interesting. While I was preparing for today's video, I just opened this brand new deck and I was quite astonished to find that some of the cards are factory, not misprints, but actual printed playing cards, but they don't have any faces. Look at this. This is not two cards stuck together. It's actually a playing card with the back printed on both sides. So as you can imagine, I was quite astonished to find the entire deck, or just a few cards from this deck, to be completely printed in this fashion. Anyway, I've noticed a few of the decks that I have contain quite a few prints like this. I rang up the United States Playing Card Company and I told them who I was. I said, tell me, can you explain to me why your decks now contain playing cards that have no faces? They said to me, Mr. Vincent, if you don't like our cards, why don't you print your own? And they hanged up on me. I thought, well, you know what? That's a red rag to a bull. So I thought, what would it look like if I could take playing cards with no faces and print my own? It would look something like this. Don't blink your eyes. Watch closely. And look, there's one card, the King of Clubs. And if you were here, I'd let you have a look at this, okay? Now, what's interesting, if you compare this king with this king, it doesn't have a face. But watch this, I can now print on it. Sorry, that's the back. To give myself another king, the King of Spades. So, but with only two cards left now, you can see nothing else in my hands. Just two cards with no faces. And there's the King of Diamonds. And last but by no means least, look at this, my friends. Sleeves rolled up, nothing else in my hand. Just a playing card with no face. And lo and behold, there's the King of Hearts. And there you have it, my friends. This is a wonderful routine called New Back Off. And you can find it in Scams and Fantasies. Another true story. I first learned this routine when I was a boy from Apocalypse. That's where I first learned it, where it was first published. And this is going way back in the 1980s, but Darwin has put together a brand new handling. I've made a few alterations to actualize and expand the atmosphere of magic right at the end with my miracle change. Anyway, that's my contribution for today. Thanks for watching. Take a look at this book. Give it your best attention and read it as a continuation of Cardshark. I think you will be pleasantly surprised. Thanks very much for watching. See you tomorrow.